In audio processing applications, we often want to perform finite impulse response FIR filtering very efficiently, for example in computer games or virtual reality audio. One way to achieve this is the fast convolution algorithm, but sometimes we simply cannot use it. What is more, it's not always the most efficient algorithm to use. When the convoluted signals are sufficiently short, and we know how to implement time domain filtering efficiently, we can achieve superior performance to the fast convolution algorithm. How? You will find that out in this video. Hi audio programmers, this is Jan Wilczek from thewolfsound.com, and if you're new to this channel, I teach you how to process sound using self-written software. In this video, I will guide you step by step how to use a powerful technique called loop vectorization to achieve efficient time domain FIR filtering. To write an efficient FIR filter, we need to start with a baseline implementation. In the previous video, we implemented a plain FIR filter that processes the samples one by one. I link to this video in the description below, but just as a short recap, to implement the FIR filter, we invert the impulse response coefficients of the filter and name them C. We also pad the input signal X with n-1 zeros at the end, where n is the length of the filter. We then, for each output sample, shift one of the signals in time and perform the inner product of the two vectors. In the figure, you can see the necessary multiplications for the first output sample. Each orange frame represents a scalar multiplication between elements of the input signal and the reversed coefficients. What's happening here should be clear when we look at the code. Remember that here we assume that our signals are already correctly initialized and zero padded. For each output sample, we compute an element of the inner product sum and add it to the output. In this structure, you can clearly see the inner loop, which computes the inner product between the input and the reversed impulse response, and the outer loop, which calculates one output sample per iteration. Two loops mean two possibilities for the powerful loop vectorization technique, and that's exactly what we'll discuss next. Inner loop vectorization, outer loop vectorization, and outer inner loop vectorization. Let's start with the inner loop vectorization. In any loop vectorization technique, we want to rewrite the loop to operate on vectors rather than on samples. Therefore, we can increment the loop counter by more than one after each iteration. In inner loop vectorization, we vectorize the inner product for one output sample. In the figure, you can see what happens when we use vectors of length 4 and we want to calculate the first output sample. Each orange frame represents an inner product between the so-called short vectors, which are simply parts of the full vectors. In this example, in one inner loop iteration, we compute four elements of the full inner product sum instead of one. This is thanks to the fact that one orange frame can be executed with a single SIMD instruction. What are SIMD instructions? I have discussed this topic in detail in another video that you can find linked to in the description below. However, for now, let's just say that these are instructions that allow us to operate on more than one variable at a time. So, in essence, operate on vectors. In inner loop vectorization, we use SIMD to calculate the parts of the inner product sum. We therefore perform fewer processor operations than in the baseline FIR implementation. Let's look how this could be written in code. As you can see, in each inner loop iteration, we compute an inner product of two four-element vectors. So we calculate four elements of the convolution sum for one output sample. That allows us to advance by 4 samples on every inner loop iteration. Now, you may say that this is just a fancy way of writing exactly the same code as before, and that's true. But this code is now trivial to rewrite with vector SIMD instructions. It's easier to explain this concept in this way rather than directly introduce specific SIMD instruction sets. If you're interested in an example implementation, I put the link to my implementation of all the described techniques using the AVX instruction set in the description below. So, in inner loop iteration, we calculated 4 elements of the convolution sum for 1 output sample. If we instead computed 1 element of the convolution sums of 4 output samples, we would have what is called the outer loop vectorization. In outer loop vectorization technique, we compute 4 output samples during 1 outer loop iteration. In the picture, you can see how it is done for the first output sample. One frame signifies one iteration of the inner loop. In each inner loop pass, we scale the 4 input samples by 1 coefficient of the filter. If that's unclear to you, don't worry, maybe looking at the code will help you. In each outer loop iteration, we calculate 4 output samples. In each inner loop iteration, we calculate 1 summand from the convolution sum of each of those output samples. The outer loop advances by 4 output samples on each iteration, whereas the inner loop advances by 1 filter coefficient on each iteration. An implementation using the outer loop vectorization is not more efficient than the one using the inner loop vectorization. What is more, we seem to be missing something by using just 1 filter coefficient in each inner loop iteration. So, can we do better than this? Yes, we can. But before we move on, I would like to ask you to subscribe to this channel. WolfSound can only reach as many people as YouTube allows. Increasing this number lies mostly in your hands. So, if you want these videos for other people to discover and learn from, please subscribe, hit the thumbs up and share this video. Thank you. You've been amazing so far and good luck on your journey to becoming an audio programmer. So, how can we speed up our FIR filtering even more? Well, by vectorizing both loops, the outer loop and the inner one. This technique is called the outer-inner loop vectorization. In this approach, we combine the 2 previous ones. We compute a vector of output samples in 1 outer loop iteration and speed up the inner product computation in the inner loop. In this figure, we again assume that our vectors are of length 4. Each frame type marks 1 inner loop iteration. In essence, we write inner loop vectorization for 4 output samples in parallel, so to say. So using in this example, 5 different SIMD registers at a time. If that's not clear to you, let's look at the code. This is very verbose, I know. You can see that both loops advance by 4 samples. Additionally, in the inner loop, you can see the same code as in the inner loop vectorization, simply repeated 4 times. That allows the compiler and the processor to rearrange the specific instructions so that the throughput is the highest possible. Okay, these were 3 loop vectorization techniques. Which one is the fastest? Well, as usual, it depends. Believe it or not, in my recent work, it turned out that the inner loop vectorization implementation outperformed the outer inner loop vectorization and resulted in much more readable code. As Bjarn Strustrup says, don't make statements about efficiency of code without first doing time measurements. guesses about performance are most unreliable. So, we should measure how each algorithm performs in our specific setting. In summary, in this video, we learned three loop vectorization techniques to speed up finite impulse response filtering. In inner loop vectorization, we speed up the inner product computation. In outer loop vectorization, we compute a vector of output samples in parallel. In outer inner loop vectorization, we combine the two techniques. We calculate a vector of output samples and speed up the inner products necessary for each of them. If you are still unsure about these techniques, be sure to check out the related article on thewolfsound.com, which I have linked to in the description below. There are also provided sample implementations of these algorithms using C++ and the AVX instruction set from Intel. You can also check out the code for this video on my GitHub. If you are interested in the topic of the efficient implementation of the FIR filter, the next video will show you how to leverage data alignment to speed up the computations even more. So in order not to miss out on this, please subscribe to the channel and turn on notifications. Thanks for watching and see you in the next video. Take care.